Well, the commercial space is a natural flow for going into a frontier environment like this. And you can see analogs of the Wild West in the United States getting settled with a combination of both government programs and government sponsored commercial programs. And I think we're going to see the same thing going into space. It's an important aspect of opening the frontier so that more than just a few government-born programs can operate in this environment. Well, I like to look at just exploration. Why is exploration important? And because it's hard to justify on any single thing, but you look historically at those countries that explored, and I like to use the transoceanic explorations of the 17th century as an example that the countries that explored were the ones that basically wrote the history of that era of time. And they're the ones that had the highest standard of living. They're the ones that advanced the art and the sciences, and their societies flourished. And you can't say, well, it's because they did oceanic exploration, but it's part of the exploration. So I like to see exploration as a metric for how viable your society is. And when you stop exploring, there's like a certain entity inside of your country that dies, and you just sort of start to atrophy. And when you continue to explore, you have a certain richness, a certain demeanor about your society that says this is a thriving place. Well, I think a part of any explorer, and you saw this 100 years ago when the Arctic and Antarctic were starting to be explored. What explorers do is they go off someplace, they come back and they tell stories. They spread their experience to those who didn't have the good fortune to go. And we're doing the same thing in the venue of space, and we're using what is available to us now. If Shackleton was able to tweet, I'm sure he would have been tweeting during his expeditions to Antarctica. And on station, we have limited time and limited bandwidth, and we have help from people on the ground that will take information that we give them, and they in turn will help get it out through the appropriate channels. I wanted to make the equivalent of a potted plant in the corner. And our spacecraft is designed for animals, for human beings, and plants don't necessarily thrive in that kind of an environment. And I wanted to try to figure out how could I have something really simple that you just have the equivalent of a green plant growing in the corner. And it took me a while to figure that out. And then I thought, well, let me write about that because the technology associated with it is not necessarily straightforward. And I thought I could make it like a gardening instruction manual, which maybe five people might be interested in reading. Or then the idea came to me, well, why don't I animate it like a jungle book, one of Kipling's jungle books, where if tigers and lions can sit there and talk to each other, why can't a zucchini sit there and talk? And so I decided I would write the story of how you raise plants in space through the eyes of a zucchini. I would go back to space in a nanosecond. That's what I do for a living, and give me another couple of days here to get my feet on the ground and I'm ready to go again. And in terms of immigrating from space, from Earth, I'd be willing to immigrate from Earth, immigrate into space, leaving Earth and never come back, so long as, one, we had the technology so that you could survive. You know, one-way missions to Mars where you go there and then run out of air and die, that's not in the cards. If you went to Mars like people went from continental Europe to the New World, in the 17th century, that model would be something I would do. I'd load my family up on the next rocket, and we'd immigrate into space.